Welcome to today's session with Chris Sowton talking about teaching in challenging circumstances. My name is Irina Siruk. I'm a senior business development manager of the Ukrainian offices, and I'm pleased to have my colleague with me. Will you introduce yourself?
Hello, everyone. My name is Tatiana Shalepko. I'm Cambridge University Press ELT consultant for the linguist company in Ukraine. And we are now having our third live session for teachers in Ukraine with Chris Sowton and a guest speaker. And today we will be talking about well-being. And we should note that it's important to keep working, keep developing professionally for educators, because that's what we're doing, building brighter futures together. And I guess Darina will now introduce our guest speaker.
Yeah, so in today's webinar, Teaching in Challenging Circumstances, we are joined by Professor Sarah Mercer, who is also head of the ELT Research and Methodology Department at the University of Graz. And Sarah is an author of Teaching Wellbeing. Sarah's main area of current research explores language teacher wellbeing, looking at how mentally and physically healthy teachers are more engaged, motivated, and efficient. And I think a lot of teachers today in Ukraine, and not only in Ukraine, but in many parts of the world, are struggling in putting themselves together first, physically, as well as mentally, in order to teach successfully. So we will be talking through one of the chapters of Chris's book to find out the answer to our questions.
And Chris Sowton, the one who actually first started this initiative, helping teachers in challenging times, the author of the book, Teaching in Challenging Circumstances. Chris, for 15 years, Chris has been working with Cambridge University Press and Cambridge Assessment English as the author. He took part in designing such courses as Unlock, Empower, and of course, Teaching in Challenging Circumstances. He has some experience in working in challenging areas such as Lebanon, Nepal, Palestine, Somalia, and now Ukraine, unfortunately. Still, he has some tips and pieces of advice how to minimize the preparation time and how to minimize resources while teaching. And today, he will be talking about how to work with the well-being of teachers and students in these hard times. So welcome.
Thank you very much, Tanya and Dasha. And hello, Sarah.
Hi, Chris. Thank you both for that kind introduction. Thank you.
And so as we start, I'm just going to pick up on a point that Tanya made there. This is very much about both student well-being, but also teacher well-being. And I think, Sarah, I'm sure you'd agree, in these sorts of difficult situations, it's often very easy for teachers to forget about themselves. And that's the completely wrong thing to do. As teachers are dedicated to their students, they want to help their students as much as they can. But to do that, teachers also have to look after themselves.
Yes, I think one of the risks for teachers is teaching is a very other-oriented profession at the best of times. And particularly when there's a high emotional climate in the classroom, it's very quick to fall into compassion fatigue and emotional exhaustion as a teacher, because you experience those emotions of your learners as well as your own emotions and processing that. So it can become a very sort of charged atmosphere and very stressful and can drain on the emotions. So I think attending to teacher well-being at times like this means that you're just giving yourself the resilience and the resources and the strength to be able to cope to the best of your ability in working with learners, creating classes, working on engagement, trying to design activities. So I think it's a time when the temptation is to give even more of yourself rather than actually just, first of all, protect yourself, give yourself your time and space that you need, and then you're in a better position to give to others and to support others.
Yeah, you talked a little bit there about compassion fatigue, and maybe another phrase we could use is the issues of vicarious trauma as well. Could you maybe say a little bit more about those and sort of how that can affect teachers and maybe some of the ways in which they can try and avoid those situations?
So I think vicarious trauma comes from a notion in therapeutic counselling, in that when you're helping people through trauma and you're helping them process their emotions, you take on board those emotions in addition to your own emotions, and you're processing those emotions as well. So it's like a sort of double whammy, if you like, that not only have you got your own emotions and your own life that you're processing, but you're dealing with those emotions that you take on board as well. So there's a certain degree of boundary setting needed to know that you're there as a teacher. You're not a psychologist. There is a clear boundary to be made, and that's a healthy boundary to make, is that there's only so far that you can take your responsibilities as a teacher in caring for others, but that there's that need to care for yourself. So creating boundaries, being able to step back a little bit, knowing when it's time to see if you can find, if there are other people around to help that are in a position to be able to help learners to process difficult emotions and trauma. And also making sure that you are find ways to completely detach from your work life, as unrealistic as that may sound, but find that you can just divert your attention to other things in your life.
And even if that's not something physical, it might be a mental break from the situation.
Absolutely. In fact, the physical break doesn't happen so easily, particularly when things are online. It's about finding something to take in your attention so that you're not always just giving your attention to those emotions in the classroom and the learner, but that you can give your attention, even if it's just escaping into a novel that you enjoy. It's giving your brain a complete detach from that situation to allow you to refresh.
Absolutely. And also at the same time, looking after yourself physically as well in this situation, which I think often we forget. You know, the number of times I've seen teachers sort of not go to the bathroom in the course of a day or forget to drink water and all these sorts of basic things. Sometimes I think when our people are in those challenging circumstances, they think it's almost irrelevant to do those things that we normally do. But it's not. It's what keeps us physically strong. And then that gives us the strength to do these other things and to manage the situation more easily.
Yeah, I think that's a really nice way that you put it, is that we tend to think the ordinary things are irrelevant. But actually, they're very, very relevant, because they're the foundation of what allow us to be able to engage and to support others and to give of ourselves as teachers. And so the what may seem small, irrelevant things are actually very big things. They're the big parts of taking care of yourself physically, giving yourself some space to do things, to be with your family, to engage in hobbies, if you've got hobbies that you can engage in. So things that allow you to detach and be yourself and to be other than a teacher for a period of time, and allow yourself to recover and recoup and to remind yourself of who you are when you're not a teacher.
Absolutely. And that, again, that word you use there, the normalcy, and to my mind, being normal or creating some kind of normality is absolutely essential in these sorts of situations. And for many of the students attending classes, it may be the most normal thing that they do in the course of the day. And it's what can be, it can be something that calms them down. It could be something they look forward to. It's something that gives them structure in the course of the day. And I think it's something that's come up in our first two sessions that actually what we've been saying is sometimes it's not what you are teaching, it's not the content, it's not the grammar point or anything like that. It's just the fact of being together in the same place at the same time with some kind of shared objective, which is such an important thing.
Yeah, I think it's that that actually routine and safety and security in that kind of what they can they know what they can expect. They know that they've got a relationship. They know they've got that social connection. That's hugely important also for the teacher as well as for the learners. So having that space where you can be together, where you've got some expectations of how things work, you've got some routines, you've got a little bit of structure. That's hugely important to give a sense of security and safety to the learners as well as to the teacher. And teachers do get an enormous amount back from being together with the learners and teaching. So teaching isn't all, yeah, sometimes we position teaching as a burden, but teaching is also incredibly rewarding. And so particularly in situations like this, teachers will get positive resonance from being able to engage in their work and work with learners. It's just about making sure that doesn't tip over into the over dedication.
Absolutely. And on that note, Sarah, what would you say, how honest should teachers be with their students in the current situation in Ukraine? What levels of honesty should we be? Because obviously students will know what's going on, or at least have a sense of it, depending on their age and all those sorts of issues, and obviously where they are within Ukraine as well. What would you be your advice to teachers who are asking that kind of question? How should we deal with those issues? How honest should we be in the classroom? How much should we allow students to talk about all of these things that are going on around them?
It's a really, really good question. And I wish there was a simple answer to it, but there's not. So the first thing that I'd like to say here is that I have never taught in a war zone or a zone of conflict or a difficult circumstance. So I'm not in a position to talk about that. So I'll talk about the things I do know about the areas that I've worked in. And I will trust the teachers here are much smarter and clued up, and I respect their knowledge that they will take from this what they think is wise to take from this. One of the things we know about working with children who've got issues, trauma, emotional issues to work through, every child is different, so it's very hard to predict. We do know that if you try to ignore things, ignore emotions, that kind of repression of emotions is not healthy either. So it's about finding that balance, I think, about the sense of normalcy and safety that the school, that the learning space gives. So allowing people to, you know, escape for a moment into other topics, into other roles, into being just a regular learner in a regular class, that's also important. And being able to maybe forget it for some time and just be concentrated on what we do as a group and in class. But on the other hand, these are huge emotions and huge issues to deal with. And it's very clear that if you repress emotions, they're going to bubble up in other places in other ways.
Yeah.
But there has to be space and time to deal with that.
You can't stop the leak, can you? You stop it one place and it will come out somewhere else, and potentially in a more violent and aggravated form.
Absolutely. So there needs to be space and time for people to talk about this and work through this. And you know, you can't ignore the elephant in the room. It's going to be addressed, and it would be bizarre to ignore it and pretend it's not happening. You can't. So I think with things like that, you will know your group and you will know best how to deal with it. Some learners may be more comfortable talking about it than others, and that's a very fine balancing line for teachers to have to walk. But I do tend to think that being honest with each other and allowing each other the space to be honest about it, and that freedom to talk and feeling comfortable that people are allowed to speak about how they feel, that they don't have to hide it, they don't have to repress it, I think that's hugely important. But how exactly a teacher does that with their specific group, I trust them to know their group is better than anybody, probably.
Absolutely. I think it's that instinct which can often really come in these sorts of situations. And for most teachers, what feels right probably is right. Like you say, you know your class, you know your situation. And it's important to say as well, in these situations, if you've never been in them before, you know, you're going to get stuff wrong. And that's absolutely fine and completely understandable. And not to beat yourself up about it if and when those sorts of things happen, but to respond, you know, next time in that different way. So often I would think, you know, go with what feels right. You know your class, each class is individual, each student is individual as well, and they're going to have different needs and different ways that they're going to respond. I was just going to talk about one thing I've done before when working with Syrian teachers in Lebanon, where they were, you know, teachers there, they were not necessarily aware of their own sort of, many of them had PTSD and weren't necessarily aware of those situations, found it very difficult to talk about those kind of things. We did a collaborative writing task. So what happened is we said, well, just write a story. And so the teachers, they all wrote the title of a story and sitting in a big circle, then they would pass it on to the person on the left. And then that person would then carry on that story with the first paragraph, write the first paragraph, then pass that on and carry on. So you end up with, you know, however many people in the group, say you come up with 10 or 12 different stories, but everybody has contributed to all of those different stories. And often you find that they start off with very kind of general titles, you know, the shop or the journey or something like that, but they start talking about the things that are on their mind very, very quickly, or they're in their subconscious, everything that's around them. And what the teachers there in Lebanon said to me was that they felt it was a really valuable because they were able to say what was on their mind, but anonymously. And yet by the end of it, they had something collective which spoke to some sort of shared experience as well.
That's
so,
a good idea.
Yeah, so I think it's something that could be very useful in a class situation with students and allowing them to use Ukrainian language as well within that situation if they want to. But it's also something that teachers can do with each other as well, potentially, if there are, you know, other teachers you're working with, if there are still people in your group that you can do those sorts of things with. So I think that collaborative thing, that collaborative task, which is positive, is a good mental thing anyway, but there's also a sort of value in the activity as well.
I think that's a lovely idea. I think being able to write about things is often easier than being able to talk about them for everybody. And so sometimes people find it easier to express themselves in writing, or maybe through art and drawing and poetry. So creative outlets for emotions, particularly with children who might still have trouble formulating their feelings in any language. Using the art, using visuals, using image, letting people draw, letting people use poetry, play with words. And that can be a very helpful way to allow them to express themselves. But I love your idea of this collaborative, this working together and having this shared story that you create. I think that's lovely. And creating some, getting learners to create shared creative works. I mean, that would also be nice.
Exactly. Yeah, you could have exactly like a class picture or something that you add to, or
yeah,
you know,
collages.
Exactly. Yeah, and also sort of, you know, using sort of recycled materials to make sort of like what we call junk modeling, or kind of creating something out of, you know, bits of plastic and wood and leaves and stick, whatever is around. Again, that's the sort of lots of language. It's an activity. It's a collective thing that students can do. I see Dash has got a hand up. I just want to say one thing in addition to what Sarah said first, just on this theme of images and stuff. Again, using emojis is such a useful thing to do, because they are, you know, certainly when emojis came out, they were pretty restricted in terms of what they could show. But nowadays, emojis show a whole range of different emotions, and students can use those to say how they feel. Like you say, if they haven't got the language either in English or in Ukrainian to be able to do this, but they can recognize that feeling, and that's a basis for discussion. So there's some stuff in my book, which, as I say, is open access and people can do, about emojis. But also there is something called a blob tree as well. I don't know if you've come across blob trees. So again, it's at the start of the book. I can't remember the exact page, but what it is, there's a tree, and there's a series of sort of stick figures almost at different points in the tree. So some are sitting on the branch happily, smiling, feeling comfortable. Some are hanging on for dear life. Some are hanging down and holding someone else up. So there's all these figures doing different things. Again, what that shows is students can point to one of these figures and say, that's how I feel. I feel fine right now. Or I feel like I'm just hanging on for dear life. Or I feel I'm holding the weight of somebody else and I'm really struggling with this. So again, it's in the book. It's a really useful image to use with students, because they can point to it. They can say, that is how I feel. I've got no way of expressing that in any language, but that's how I feel. And those sorts of things can be really valuable at this point in the cycle.
Yeah, I think one thing that's become very popular in classrooms all over the world are these emotional check-ins. And an emotional check-in, you can do it at the beginning of class, middle of class, end of class, you can do it repeatedly. And these often use emojis or sort of images where people can just point and say, that's how I'm feeling right now. And they can also point usually to say, I want to talk about this. I don't want to talk about this. I might want to talk about this later. So that they can just give the teacher a guide of where they're at and where their emotions are at the moment.
Absolutely, yeah. And Dasha has showed her feelings on the issue by making herself visible and saying, you've been talking for far too long, so now I want to say something. So yeah, go on, Dasha.
No, I'm enjoying your conversation, listening to your pieces of advice a lot. Just like to remind our teachers that if they have questions, they can either add them into the Q&A if they're following us on Zoom, and you can comment on our live stream on Facebook. And we also have some questions that we received up front. And one of the questions I'd like to voice over to you, because I think it's referencing a lot to what you're saying. Children that witnessed war actions are sensitive to numerous everyday topics. Should I adjust my lessons accordingly? And what are the recommended topics to distract them from heavy thoughts? And if a child wants to share his stories of war, should this be allowed during the lesson?
Sarah, do you want to go ahead and share your thoughts on that one?
So I think we've talked a little bit about that, in the sense that it's important to have that time and space to do it. And I think each teacher will know their own group about how they're comfortable to do that in what space. The question of topics is difficult because, of course, all kinds of things can act as triggers for children who've experienced trauma. So they may have witnessed what would normally be considered an everyday scene in a traumatic form. So even just talking about going to the shops or going to the post office, something that might seem very ordinary can act as a trigger for that child. So it's very, it is a little bit of a challenge to, you can't know that for every child that you work with. And this is where I think this ability to be creative can be very useful, and allowing freedom and allowing a lot of, I think one of the things that can be quite important for children in difficult circumstances is that they may feel a loss of control. They may feel a loss of agency, and it can be really helpful to give a sense of empowerment back to them, to feel that they've got something they control by giving choice, and helping learners to choose topics and options and activities to the best of your ability. So even if it's just a choice between two things that they want to work with, that can have the effect that, one, you feel a bit more comfortable that they're going to be comfortable with the topic because they've chosen it, but also it can be quite empowering for learning. It gives them a sense of choice and agency, so they've been able to make a decision in their lives. And at a time when all that ability to make decisions about what happens to you has disappeared, being able to make some choices, no matter how small they are, between do we do option A or do we do option B, let's have a vote on this, that can be really empowering to the learners and very important. And it can give the teacher useful information about which option they chose and why.
Absolutely. And it can even be, you can even say that down to the individual level. When you give a task, you say, well, you can do it as a speaking task, or you could do it as a written task, you know, depending on how you're feeling at that particular point.
Yeah. And the more we can find those little options for choices, you know, you might want to work this on your own quietly, or you might decide you want to work with somebody else on this together. Or you might decide you want to make a little group of three or four. So there's always it's not just the what they learn that they can choose, but the how they learn it, and whether they learn it with others, whether they do it in writing, speaking, how they decide to create the output from a task. Those kind of choices of the what and the how, when it's possible, can be incredibly empowering, and can help the learner can guide you. It doesn't have to be you making the decision. The learner can guide you to what kind of support they need and what kind of things they would like to work on.
Absolutely. And it's also less stressful for you as a teacher, because you're not going through, sometimes you look at sort of detailed lesson plans and you're supposed to come up with sort of individual learner profiles and how they like to learn and all this kind of stuff, you know, in challenging circumstances, when you're trying to just, you know, manage a classroom of scared or frightened kids. That's impossible to do, you know, but what you can do is let people make those decisions themselves. Don't presume that they like doing this or that student likes doing that or whatever it may be. Keep it open. Again, we don't have to be driven by the learning outcome. It's not about that. It's about finding a way through that everybody is comfortable with.
That's right. Yeah. And I think that learners are usually quite good at communicating what they like and what they don't like.
Not what they don't like, yeah.
So you know, let them do that and let them guide us a little bit. In all circumstances, I think that can be helpful.
Absolutely. Just coming back to the question that that Dasha asked as well about topics and so on. What I would also add to what Sarah said is being very careful. If you're using kind of the books which you've been always sort of using before, just be really careful about, because some of the content in there, which in normal times may be absolutely fine, will not be in these current times. So even things like, you know, basic topics like daily schedules or talking about my house or, you know, sports I like playing or whatever, these things which, you know, are the basis of many, many textbooks, you know, Cambridge and others across the world, the fact that, you know, their daily schedule is all over the place at the moment, the fact their house may have been bombed, the fact that they're not doing their normal things, the very act of talking about those can be a triggering process. So it's being really careful about those sorts of things. So sometimes what I suggest in these situations, it can be helpful to do sort of activities that visualize the future, that students sort of, there, it's more abstract, but it is also something sort of real, you know. What will you be doing in 10 years' time? You know, along, not what are you going to be doing next week or next month, but, you know, in 10 years' time, what do you want to be? Where will you go? All those sorts of things. There's enough distance there, so it doesn't feel too sort of all-encompassing and too pressured, but there's still lots of good language that can come out of those sorts of situations.
Yeah, so I had the good fortune to speak to somebody who worked with students in Syria recently, and he was talking about how the fact that for his learners, or the people that he was talking to, these future imagined selves, so imagining yourself in the future doing certain things, what would you like to be doing, where would you like to go, and also maybe in English, what would you like to do in English, where would you like to go with your English, what would you like to be doing, who would you like to meet, this future envisioning and using your imagination, but having this kind of vision of a future that can be quite motivating for learners and can be a, he found it for his learners as a kind of imaginative escapism.
Nice phrase. Yeah, that, yeah.
That was.
Yeah. And just before we come to Tanya, I just wanted to add as well, just on the issue of triggers, because I think it's a really crucial issue. Mm. It's also about those normal every things in a normal situation that you kind of go by without you even thinking about them. Things like, you know, alarms on your phone or bells or the sound of a motorbike or whatever it may be, you know, in these situations can be have a very triggering effect for your students. Now, obviously, it can be difficult to sort of stop some of those noises, but others, there can be ways of managing that. So it's just trying to be as aware as possible that there may be triggers that we just don't even know about. Or if we do find out that some things trigger other students, we can try and sort of manage that. Tanya, yes, you wanted to jump in.
Yeah, I wanted to jump in with a question about like we have multi-level classrooms, right? But in today's situation, like how to deal with the remote lessons, because this is the reality of Ukrainian education now. How to deal with the remote lessons where children in the classroom have different emotional states from very different experiences of the war in different parts of Ukraine. Some of them were harmed more, some less. So how to deal with that? Any tips?
Yeah. Sarah, did you want to
No, I was going to let you take that. That's a really difficult one, and you've got more experience in this kind of context than I have, so.
I mean, what I would say, we've obviously learned a lot because of COVID about this sort of remote teaching. And I think so going forward, we will maybe in a future edition of this webinar, we'll get someone with more expertise in online teaching. But what I would say basically is what we've said in the previous sessions. It's about trust. You can develop trust online as well as face to face. It can be more difficult to do that, but it's, you know, I think it's going to be teaching with, if it's with your existing class, as it were, it's remembering the relationships that you had when you taught them face to face and building that, not forgetting that, not thinking this is a new start and there's no sort of history or anything like that. You know, you have a solid base. So it's kind of a natural extension of what's been going before. And I would say, you know, it's not about, as a teacher online, it's not about being just a talking avatar. You're not a robot. You're still their teacher. You've still got that sort of compassion for them. You've still got that relationship with them. And I think that's a really, really important to remember too. Well, I would say, go ahead, Sarah.
No, I was just going to build on what you just said in that what some of the work that we did with teachers and students during COVID and remote teaching, the thing that came out most strongly is the importance of social emotional learning and the centrality of remote relationship, and that you can still work on building that relationship, getting learners to do things together, getting them to build relationships with each other, and you build up a network of relationships and trust. And that's hugely important, more so than maybe some of the language elements, that you're working on a basis of relational trust. You create something when you work and you build up this network of relationships between you and the learners, but also among the learners, you create something called psychological safety. And it's that sense of security, that sense of belonging, the sense that you share things together, that you've got shared ways of doing things, that you have things that you remember together, that you talk about together, that you plan things for the next lesson. And you said, remember what we did in the last lesson. Even those little bits of connecting the experiences you've had together builds that sense of group and that sense of relationship. And having that relational network around you gives you a sense of psychological safety, that you're not alone, that you're with others, that you're part of a community, that you're part of a group. I think that's hugely important.
Absolutely. And if, for example, your learners don't feel comfortable to talk about their experiences in that situation, you know, one thing you could do is ask them to email you with their experience, or email you how they're feeling, and then you can share that anonymously in a future class, you know. So there's a way that you can raise these issues in that sort of situation. Also saying to students, look, if at any point you feel uncomfortable, just take a break. You know, you don't have to ask permission. You don't have to, you can just, you know, go and take a break, you know, if you're feeling in that particular situation. You could also as well, this is something my wife, she's a child counselor, and something that she's done before is she says at the start of the lesson, she says to them, well, at the end of the lesson, I'm going to leave the room open. And if you want to, the students can talk to each other. You can talk to each other. I won't be there. I'm going to go. I'll turn my, you know, I'm going to close it, but I will keep it open for you to talk should you wish to. So again, it's those sorts of things that you can do just to normalize it, to make, as you say, create that feeling of psychological safety, that there are things in this group that we can all share, that we can all benefit from.
Even just getting learners to work on tasks. So, you know, even if they're not talking about their emotions of the moment, but if they're doing something like a creative activity, if they're doing something creative, they're doing some imaginative activity with language, working on something together also is part of that relationship building. So collaborative tasks, cooperation, working with each other, that kind of building of peer support, that's part of generating that. And that doesn't have to have anything to do with tackling emotions head on. That can just be about simply getting them to work with each other and to build up that kind of peer support. So that feeling that you're in a group and that you're together with others, and that those others work with you and hang out with you and know you. And the simple things of making sure everybody knows each other, knows each other's names, and maybe you've got something personal you want to tell about yourself, your favorite, I don't know, favorite color, or you know, something that you want to talk about. So that kind of way of helping learners connect with each other.
Yep, thank you. Dasha.
You're actually answering most of the questions we've had received from teachers before, so I'm not repeating them, but there is the question coming from Facebook, from Mila Grishko. Are there any types of tasks which, in your point, help to relieve the stress in the classroom, the touching the topic of work and play?
So how to relieve stress in a class, any types of tasks? I would refer back to sort of a couple of the things we talked about last week with Nick Bilbra. You know, the use of things like role play and drama can be very beneficial for that, because you're creating this artificial situation, but one which is also grounded in reality, but perhaps a version of reality, a manageable version of reality. And I think often you'll find in that situation as well that they can be both fun, but also students can laugh. And I think laughter is such a crucial thing to try and create in this situation. And again, other tasks which I've used which can kind of make students laugh, just things like, I think you were just mentioning before, Sarah. So for example, you know, ranking activities with the students where you have to get them to move around. So you might say, well, just organize yourself tallest to shortest, and then the students will move around to do that. And then you see them sort of rearranging each other, you know, to do that. And then you can, once they understand that, you can do more complex things like, you know, arrange yourselves from January to December in terms of when your birthdays are. Then they have to talk more to find out those sorts of things. And you'll see how students love doing that sort of stuff, and they push each other, and it's in a fun way, and it can lead to lots of laughter. So I think any activities which can, you know, they have a language learning point, but they're fun and can lead to laughter are really important things to try and do.
I think it's allowing them also. I think, you know, I'm actually thinking of Nick and some of the hands up things about this role of drama and art and the creative arts. I think they're such a key outlet at the best of times, and we tend to undervalue them, but particularly in situations like this, because they allow learners to express emotions that they want to express and also bring in humor on their terms. I had students, this was one of my very first schools I ever worked at, and some of the kids had very difficult backgrounds. It was a school in a low socioeconomic area, and we decided to do Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, but they made Snow White was the head teacher, who was male. Yeah. So they made him Snow White, and the Seven Dwarfs, they picked seven of the teachers and they wrote a play, and they wrote, it was in English, they did it themselves, and it was a bit of a spoof on the fairy tale. And they did the most incredible stuff, and they wrote this themselves, and then they performed it at the end of the school year. So I tend to be a firm believer that the arts and drama and creativity can be a great outlet for, one, using and playing with language and learning language, but also allowing you to slip into other roles and take on other perspectives.
Absolutely. And as you're saying there, things which are a bit transgressive, things which change the established order of things, you know, because there is so much chaos that's going on in their lives and what they see around them, it's not, I wouldn't say it's embracing the chaos, but it's recognizing that life is slightly chaotic. And then if you are changing people's roles in those situations, you know, male and female roles in things, old and young, those sorts of things, it's playing with that idea of chaos. But I think what can be so powerful in those situations is that students can find a way to resolve these issues. In the collaborative writing task I mentioned before that I did with Syrian teachers in Lebanon, what was really interesting about all their stories was that they did have a positive ending. Mm-hmm. So they were talking about all of these challenging things, and then I said, well, now you've got to bring the story to a close. All of them brought it to a positive close, and I think there is that instinct, that there is that optimism that is there, however deep down it may be. But doing things creatively, role play, drama, et cetera, creates an opportunity for people to be optimistic and to think about that, like you say, that positive future that we mentioned before.
I think one of the, somebody asked about things to relieve stress is, one of the key things is being able to try and find pockets of positivity. So that doesn't mean, you know, you can't deny the trauma and the reality, but trying to find little moments of positivity, little things that give them a moment of seeing something positive, thinking about something positive. It can be future, it can be in the present, it can be that the sun was shining today, that I spoke to my friend on Facebook, that finding those moments of positivity and being very conscious about those can act as a kind of anchoring so that the negativity doesn't overweigh. So it's not to be facile and just say you ignore the negativity and the trauma and the difficulty that's going on, but there will also be little moments of positivity, little positive encounters, little things that they enjoy, little things that give them a moment of happiness. It might be flowers that are coming in the park. It can be all kind, you know, it's different things for different people, but helping them to talk about those things, to find those things. And it contributes to what you were just talking to. It helps people to find a little bit of positivity, helps them to redress that stress level, because it is a counter, finding positive things is a counter to stress. And it also gives them a little bit of a sense of balance and contributes towards optimism and resilience.
Yeah. So
it's not to be facile about positive things. And it's not that, it's just about that it's helping them to redress the balance and give them a tool to help them consciously try and find things around them or in their minds or in their memories, things that they want to draw on moments of positivity.
And there's different ways you can do that. So one way might be circle time, for example, at the beginning or the end of the day, where everyone sits in a circle and, like you say, says something positive, however small that might be. One thing that they enjoyed about the session today, or one thing that sort of made them happy in the last day. Or that could be done anonymously, individually, by sort of writing something on a piece of paper and sticking it onto, you know, the class notice board, and everyone does that. Again, what's nice about that is that students might see what somebody else has written and thought, oh yeah, I also think that as well. I hadn't thought about that, but she said she saw, yeah, flowers coming through in the park, and actually that's quite a nice thing. I'll look for that when I go home. So there's a way of sharing those experiences and then sort of prompting more positive things. So it can be a sort of positive trigger, not just these sort of negative triggers.
That's right. So I think looking for positive triggers, and also one of the things I think in trauma sensitive pedagogy is also helping learners to identify their strengths. So not just empowering them with this decision making, so this choice and voice that's so important for learners to feel a sense of agency in difficult circumstances, but also helping them to find what they're good at, find their strengths, focusing on when they did something, what did they do well, and helping them to recognize that as well. So I think a strengths-based approach is a big part of trauma-sensitive pedagogy, is that to give them a little bit of a boost of confidence, that they remember what they did, that they see what they've achieved, that they celebrate achievements as individuals and groups, that a little bit more fast perhaps than normal is made of small steps of achievement, to give them that sense of progress, to give them a sense of they've achieved something, they've had that moment of success. So I think
we're seeing things sort of relatively rather than normatively. It's like distance traveled. It's sort of, I could do this, which I couldn't do last week, or I noticed this, which I didn't notice last week. You know, these are not normal times, and we need to recognize that. So our way of evaluating and measuring that is perhaps different.
Yeah, and I think particularly learners, but also teachers, want to feel that they've got a sense of control, but they want to feel that they've got something that they're good at, that they're making progress at, that there's some sense of moving forward, and highlighting that and making that particularly visible, making it very explicit, can be quite empowering for the learners as well as for the teacher.
So coming to practical terms, that might be, you know, having clear objectives in the lesson about what you're going to do, and then at the end of the lesson reviewing those objectives about what was done. You know, and those objectives don't have to be, you know, huge at all, but just that recognition that here's something that you can do, or that you know at the end of the lesson that you didn't know or couldn't do at the start of the lesson. Because in these difficult situations, yeah, you need to feel like you're moving forward. If you're not moving forward, you're sort of going backwards.
Yeah, and I think, you know, can-do statements got a bit of a bad rap for being sort of overdone a little bit, but I think can-do statements at times like this can be really useful, because it's like, yeah, what can I do? Actually, I can do this, and I can do that, and I can do that. And, you know, the traditional thing where, you know, when we look at a text, we used to underline the words you don't know. Well, this is very much a case. Underline all the words you know. Just leave blank the ones you don't know. So just that switching on its head and really focusing on the positive, focus on what I can do, focus on what I can achieve, that can be particularly important in times like this.
Yeah, I love that, changing the narrative, just like you say, underlying what you do know. You know, we're seeing it in a positive terms too often. In challenging circumstances, everything is looked at in deficit terms. What can't we do? What are the problems? What, you know, how can I manage the problem of having a large class, rather than what can I do with all these students? You know, so, and that mental change can have such a huge impact. Just the way in which you look at it can change how you react to that and what you can do.
That's right. Also, I think it's also particularly for, you know, for also for teachers to say, you know, there's a lot of things I can't do right now, but there are still things I can do. So what can I do? What is in my control? And how can I feel a sense of progress and a sense of achievement as a teacher? And I think it's also important for teachers' well-being to help teachers to focus on what they are doing and how they are managing, and celebrate their own successes in coping in extremely difficult circumstances.
Absolutely. So Tanya's got a hand up, and as I can see in the chat, Tanya and Dasha are getting angry with us, so we're not letting them talk. So not really.
No, we're not getting angry, but the teachers are getting more interested.
Ah, okay.
So they were commenting on the moments of positivity, that, yeah, it's really important and good idea to pay attention to those. And also we have another question from Julia Hryshko, the same teacher. It seems that more formative assessment should be used in the classroom to create the sense of achievement, shouldn't it?
Yeah.
He's spot on the mark.
And it also, I think you've got to look at it, you know, is it fair to do summative assessment at the moment? You're not going to get any kind of meaningful, useful data from doing that. You're just going to create stress and anxiety at a time where that needs to be minimized.
Yeah, I think she's captured it perfectly, in that this is the time to look at what's helping us feel a sense of achievement and progress. And that's what formative assessment about, is that kind of feedback process. But again, thinking about our feedback process, that we also talk about, you know what, this is something you did really well. I wonder where we can transfer that skill to other settings. How can you build on that? This is something that I loved about what you did. Look how you use this. Look how you use these connectors. I think that's fantastic. So also being very conscious in the kind of feedback we give in this kind of formative assessment, that formative assessment can be about constructive criticism, but it can also be about constructive praise and constructive positive feedback, which to be constructive, it has to be very precise. So we need to say exactly, so we can't say that was good and then we tell them what we really mean, that we have to say, I love the fact that you use these linking words. You had beautiful paragraphs here.
Yeah.
I love the fact you always got the LY right on the adverbs here. That was great. Well done for noticing that. So that we really pinpoint very positive things that they did well.
I was going to say that noticing is so important, but not just in terms of language production. It can be things like, you know, I noticed how well you worked with the other students. So, you know, so it's their behaviours as well as the outcomes.
That's right. And that's hugely important, because we often call out kids when they don't behave well. You know, we're the first ones to jump on something when they're not doing it well. But it's so important to call out good behaviour, you know, where you actually say, thank you, I loved how you did this together. I'm really grateful that you worked so well together and that you've done this beautiful poster that you made together. And then that you also praise their creativity, that you praise their sense of investment, that you praise that it's not just about the language and accuracy, but that it's also about other things. And I think this commenting on what we appreciate and what we've noticed, this comes back also to the importance of learners feeling seen, that they need to be seen, they need to know that they're known. And so commenting, making sure that we comment on learners in a positive sense, And say, Chris, I appreciate the fact you're nodding at me and that you're smiling at me. I can see that you're engaged and you're paying attention. So that you call out them by name and you can give them some kind of positive feedback. And it's not just that, you know, using their name and commenting specifically means they've been seen, that they're not visible. And I think that being made visible, being seen, being acknowledged is especially important just now.
Well, I've got a nice little dopamine hit there. Thank you. Thank you for that. But also we have a good example before we come to Dasha. We have a good example in the comments on Facebook from Sergei at the Department of Foreign Languages and Faculties of History and Philosophy at Taras Shevchenko National University of Kiev. He is modeling this because he's saying the electricity is cut off in my area, but I'm still standing. So that's a sort of relative way of looking at things, you know, distance travel. This is what I can do. This is what is possible, not what is not possible. So is that kind of mentality which needs to be transposed to the classroom as well. Dasha, yeah, you're getting upset because Tanya's been having all the questions. So over to you.
No, we still have a lot and a lot of comments. Yeah, thanks for noticing Sergei's comment. I think everybody has to stay strong these days. So Sergei, stand strong with all of us. We have a nice comment that constructive praise rather than constructive criticism with regards to formative assessment. And my question, well, you've partially taken that already, but the question we received prior to the session is, should we keep the balance of developing all the life skills or working on emotional development should prevail?
What do you think, Sarah? So how much should we be focusing on, let's say, life skills, core skills, 21st century skills, whatever we want to discuss, or emotional development? Or do we not need to sort of differentiate them in this way?
Yeah, it's a good question. So for me, emotional regulation and well-being competences are life skills. They are part of life skills. My understanding of contemporary life skills is that it includes things like the traditional, you know, critical thinking, creativity, collaboration, but it also includes things like well-being and emotional regulation. Now, all of those, as you say, are very interwoven. So we've talked a lot about the value of collaboration, the benefits of fostering creativity, thinking outside the box, being able to turn things on their head and think positively. So all of that is already life skills. We're already addressing those and getting learners to work with each other, communicate together, engage in creative activities. And emotional self-regulation and well-being competences are ones that are bound to dominate at a moment like this. And I think that's about building relationships, allowing emotional recognition, allowing people to talk about their emotions, allowing them to be able to identify what those emotions are, being able to think about relationships and how they communicate with others. For us and for learners, developing the skills of active listening. So being able to engage in conversations where we take note of the other person and we listen and we build empathy, that ability to perspective switch. All of those are part of emotional regulation and relationship building, and they're also part of life skills. So they're not separate. So I think many of the things that we've talked today about are already embedded in, I think they're already covering those kinds of skills.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I would also just want to add, I think it's important not to look at this from a, not to look at the issue of emotional development from a medical perspective or a psychological perspective, particularly. You know, you are not therapists, you are not psychologists. And it's really important to remember that. That's not your job as teachers, and it shouldn't be expected. You are frontline workers, and often frontline workers have that guilt. They feel they should be able to do everything, you know, first aid, you know, mental first aid, physical first aid, you know, all those. It's not possible to do that. But what you can do is create an atmosphere and a classroom space which allows those things to evolve and develop, you know, so students can develop confidence, they have positive working relationships, all those things that they're able to regulate. That might be the physical way that you structure the classroom. Just something as simple as having a corner space where students can go at any point if they feel like it, and it's just got a few cushions there, a couple of books, whatever. It doesn't have to be much, and they can just go and self-regulate in that space. They can just go and have a sit down if they all feel it's too much. But it may also be things that you can build into your lessons, just things like grounding exercises, breathing exercises, ways of calming down. So maybe just at the start of the session, in your circle, just five deep breaths in and out, just things like that, that you're creating a sort of landscape, an ecosystem where these things can happen. But you're not psychologists, you're not therapists. And as I say, it's really important to kind of say that you're not going to fix your students. Okay. And it's a harsh thing to say, but it is a truth, I think.
I think one of the things that I've been thinking about recently and that I've become a little bit more sensitized to is that there's a difference between trauma-informed practices and trauma-sensitive. So trauma-informed is when it's therapeutic and it's through people who are trained psychologists. Trauma-sensitive is something that educators can do in being sensitive to things, but you're not supposed to be able to address and deal with the trauma in that way. So I think we can think of ourselves as being sensitive in how we respond to those things as best we can, but it doesn't mean that we're there to provide solutions. That's beyond our competences. And we come back, I think, and this is, you know, looking at the time, this is a good thing to come back to at this stage, is we're looking at teacher wellbeing as a cornerstone for this, is knowing your boundaries and knowing what you can do and celebrating what you can do and what is in your control, but also knowing what is beyond.
Absolutely, yeah. As you said, just on the time front, we are sort of coming towards the end. I just wanted to, before that, just to share with you. So so chapter 30, hopefully you can see on the screen, chapter 30 of Teaching in Challenging Circumstances, which there was a link to in the page earlier on, and which you can get access to. This is all about this issue, supporting yourself and others. Again, this key point which Sarah just mentioned again there, and it's got more information. It kind of talks about a lot of the themes that we've talked about before. So look, for example, here, just some of these normal classroom practices: being inclusive, clear instructions — it's something we've not talked about — but just so people know what they've got to do and when, and don't get stressed about those sorts of things, managing where students sit. These are just good classroom practices, but they become perhaps even more important at these particular times. So there's lots and lots of information there for you to sort of look at. I just wanted, before we go, to point out this quotation here by Madge Bray, because I think it's really important. "A child's current behavior often reflects an essentially sane response to an untenable set of life circumstances." Even if you see your students, you know, behaving badly, let's say, you know, actually to them, it might make complete sense the way that they're responding, because we just don't know sort of what's going on to them. So, you know, it's not about judging their behavior in the classroom. It's thinking, what can we do to manage that situation as effectively as possible?
And I think we come back to this idea of thinking about the positive framing of things, that when we're asking learners whose behavioral issues are disrupting things, that we don't frame this in terms of don't do this and don't do that, because there's a lot of things they can't do. But frame it in terms of, I'd like you to do this, I'd like you to do that. So I call it naming the desired behavior. So telling the learner, you know, that they're used to hearing a lot of what they can't do right now and what they shouldn't do and what they're not allowed to do. And so reframing those kinds of things also in terms of positive statements, where we say, I'd like you to do this, I'd like us as a group to do this. That kind of positive framing of desired behaviors, naming it in those terms, can also just help. It may sound like a small thing, but it can also help in giving the child orientation and not making them feel they're being restricted again, but give them a direction and give them orientation and give them that sense of empowerment, perhaps.
Brilliant. Now we have Dasha and Tanya with their hands up, and I don't know what to do, so I'm going to let you fight over that.
Yeah, it's just a sign for you to, because the time is coming to an end, unfortunately. But I think we are ending on the very, very positive note, that we're still concentrating on the positivity of the lesson of each student, despite all the challenging circumstances and situations they are going through. Yeah, and What we would like to add that to support our learners and teachers, we've come up with a brilliant landing page. Well, it just unites all of our resources. We will share them in the chat right now.
Done.
Yeah, I did it too. I think that was the first. So you can see and take a look on the instant activities you can do with your students if you are short of time. If your students are feeling distressed and you want to cheer them up, check our free resources and a lot of the games that can definitely help them fight their state at the moment.
And from me, thank you very much. That was a really, really important talk, especially the moment that we should remember that we are not therapists, and that was a really good point. Thank you for that. And that from me. And thank you at all for the whole initiative, for joining this session. I think it is really important for teachers to feel that they are supported in this field as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chris.
Thank you.
Sarah, we'll have the recording of this video on our Facebook, so we'll have a lot of teachers following up on the video as well, I'm sure. Thank you very much, and have a lovely weekend, everyone.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.